I'm in Nixa, Missouri, right?
That's right.
Okay, and we're at your gym here, right?
Lift Gym.
Lift Gym.
Not my gym.
It's not your gym?
Sam and Michelle Clifton are the owners of the gym.
Okay, so what's your job here?
Previously, I was running the gym full-time as a manager, handling classes, programming, and then just, I guess, organization of the gym, staff, and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Late in this season, I was traveling a lot and doing a bunch of stuff on the athlete end, so I pulled away. And I'm no longer doing the full-time gig here, so, but we're still running smooth and growing, and it's a good spot.
So if you're not doing this full-time, what are you doing full-time then?
Full-time training now.
Training for what?
The CrossFit Games.
CrossFit Games. Now, you're no stranger to CrossFit Games. You've made the games on a team.
Yep. Twice on a team, 2017 and 2018, and then my first year as an individual was the strange year, which was 2020.
Yeah. So you made it an online competition of that, and you weren't able to advance for that. But talk about that. Right. I mean, your first experience going individual, you make the games. You did really great in the Open. I think you finished, what, top 15 in the Open or top 10, wasn't it?
I think I was 7th or 8th.
Yeah, it was top 10. Definitely, I think 7th or 8th.
Something like that.
But yeah, talk about that experience. I mean, you know, first year going individual.
Yep.
You know, you make the games through the Open. A great performance in the Open.
Yep. So that Open was actually the one where we did it in the late fall.
Mm-hmm.
It was like the 2019.
Yeah.
I want to say it was like October.
It was when we still had the sanctionals and everything.
Yeah. Yep. And it was, I knew I was going to take a shot at the Open. I had been historically or previously, I had had some good finishes in the Open. Mm-hmm. I was like, man, I'm just going to take a, throw a haymaker at this Open, and wound up having a great Open. And then that was the year that I think it was like the really stretched out year too. Mm-hmm. So I qualified really early. And I did like a last minute invite to the Mayhem Classic.
Yeah.
And then I think that's whenever there might've been like one or two other competitions, and then mm-hmm. everything started to get shut down because the worldwide pandemic that we got ourselves into.
Yeah, because I believe the Mayhem Classic was in January. And then that following March is when everything pretty much shut down. So
yeah, I want to say there was like Mayhem Classic, maybe did Wadapalooza
happen? Yeah, Wadapalooza.
Maybe like one more.
Yeah, I think Australia, Brazil, one of those ones overseas. Yeah. And then pretty much shut down after that. Yeah, because I knew you had a couple other competitions you were planning on competing at, weren't you, to finish up 2020 before the games?
I want to say I was going to do one more. I can't remember which one it was now, looking back on it, but... Yeah, that was a strange year. I felt like we all didn't really know like when the games was gonna happen, mm-hmm. if it was gonna happen. I felt like we were all just kind of like, you know, training at that intensity of like, is this dangerous? Because we're like, you know, normally CrossFit Games athletes are used to, you know, a regional format where mm-hmm. it's like the May time, and then they take a little bit of time off maybe, and then they really like train and try to peak for that late July, August time. And that training is a ton of fun doing that, but that is like not sustainable mm-hmm. long term. So all of us going into stage one, we're kind of like, we're just glad that we got to be there first mm-hmm. off, because there was so much speculation about whether or not we were going to get to do it or not get to do it. Obviously, we wound up doing it online because it wasn't we weren't able to get it in person.
Mm-hmm.
I think they really tried to do that too,
sure.
But yeah, definitely a strange experience. Not only will I remember it as like my first time qualifying, but man, we did everything that we could to try to make that happen.
Yeah.
So that was that was a weird year.
As weird as that was, you're able to actually have, you know, do the games, your first games in your home gym.
Right.
And you actually had people here. I mean, that's quite an experience right there. I mean, talk about that experience, like having everyone here, you know, the games in your backyard essentially, and having people here rooting you on, and talk about that.
I would say like, me and Bailey had a lot of conversation about this, of like how grateful, you know, just to be able to do this here
mm-hmm.
With families or like really close people who maybe wouldn't get to travel to go to the games. I guess you would say it would be bittersweet. Like every single athlete,
mm-hmm.
you know, something that is motivating, you know, I'm not going to say it's the whole reason why you do it, but it's something that's motivating to go compete at the games would be to get in the stadium and, you know, around the fans and the crowd and even the other athletes,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, a huge factor in training and like wanting to go do that is just to go try to get to compete against the best that have ever done it or the best in the field, and just to get to line up next to those guys and get a chance to kick it, just to see what you're made of and test it with those guys. That's the part that you miss not being mm-hmm. able to do it in an in-person competition. But on the sweet side of things, it is cool to get to have like your whole gym family and like all the people that are here, you know, helping you out, working out alongside you, or, you know, to let them get to be a part of that experience was pretty neat.
Yeah. Well, let's fast forward it then to this past season. Whole new format. We had, you know, the Open, then we had basically quarterfinals, and then the what do you want to call them, the semifinals.
Semis, yep.
And then after semifinals for you, it was you had a unique opportunity where you qualified for the Last Chance.
Yep.
But let's start with the Open.
Sure.
You know, you go, we're back to the January Open.
Yep.
January, February Open. You're coming right off your game, so you had a little bit of time to recover. Mm-hmm. And then you went right into the Open. I mean, and you talked about the training. Now, knowing that the Open doesn't matter as much as it did in the past, mm-hmm. it's not a direct qualifier, how do you train for that?
First, I'll start with, I made the move to go with Mayhem programming.
Yes.
That was like in November, December. So luckily mm-hmm. for me, the approach, I didn't have to do all that stuff on my own. Partnered up with Jake Lockhart from Mayhem mm-hmm. and Rich and that whole crew. I went and visited like in November, Bailey and I both did. And I was like, I feel like this is the best direction for us to go moving forward. So Jake really helped me navigate going into an Open and, you know, having me fit, but not like running yourself into the ground type of volume and intensity all the time. So it wound up working out well. I can't remember what the percent of people that moved on from the Open was.
I think it was 10%.
Like top 10%.
Top 10%.
It's like you're pretty confident that if you've put the time in, mm-hmm. this much time in, and you're that dedicated and focused on it, you're going to make it into that top 10%. If, you know, as long as you don't have any stumbles or injury, obviously. So
sure.
It's like you want to play more of like an injury-free game mm-hmm. early in the season and don't do anything silly that could jeopardize like really that middle to end part, which is what's the most crucial for, I would say, us and the goals that we have in the space.
Yeah, so you move on to quarterfinals, which is, like I said, that middle space there.
Yep.
Did you do the quarterfinals here or did you do down in Cookeville?
We did the quarterfinals here. So okay. We did our Open here. I think they took a week off. I want to say it was like 3 weeks on, 1 week off, and then a weekend full of workouts was the quarterfinals. Mm-hmm. And then we did those here. And then we got invited to Cookeville for the semifinals, which they were hosting, I think, five athletes there.
Yep.
I think that's right. Five. Yeah. Five or six athletes were for that semifinal. I wanted to. My season was a little bit different because in the quarterfinals, my brother was getting married.
Oh, okay.
And my brother got married early this spring, and he asked me to be his best man. Of course,
what?
I miss my brother's wedding.
Oh yeah.
So I'm like, so I knew. I was like, okay, my 2021 season could potentially be cut short. Like, let's say they would have assigned us in the past. They just assign you to a regional, right? You don't get to pick.
Mm-hmm.
So I had just come to terms with like, my season could look like CrossFit assigning me to the May date that my brother was getting married, and I would have had to decline the invite.
Mm-hmm.
And I was already like coming to terms with that anyway before they even announced the structure.
Yeah.
So then when they announced that quarterfinals would give you you could bid.
Choose
based on your rank.
Yeah.
I kind of took the same mentality of like, okay, I'm going to throw like a massive punch at the quarterfinals here to try mm-hmm. to get a bid so I can try to get into a weekend that's not my brother's wedding. So my quarterfinal experience, I had a good string of workouts and wound up having a pretty good placement for my mm-hmm. own bid. So the way it laid out was the Mid-Atlantic was on his wedding weekend.
Yeah.
And then the Granite Games was the following weekend. Mm-hmm. So he got married in Louisiana, and I was like, man, I obviously couldn't swing the Mac.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I don't know if I want to try to swing going to a 3-day like wedding event, turn it coming home, then trying to pack and go to Granite Games up in, was it in
Minnesota
this year?
Minnesota.
Was it in the same spot?
No, they changed it this year. They had it
Vikings
facility.
Yeah, that's right.
So it was all outdoors, so you did.
Yeah. I feel like I would have liked the Granite Games, but
I think the programming would have fit you pretty well.
I like the programming there, but I don't know if I would have swung that turnaround well.
Yeah.
That'd have been like in the back of my mind. Obviously I would have done my best, but
mm-hmm.
so the kind of the last effort was the Atlas Games, which was the online competition. I'm gonna say there's one other one, was the Vegas one.
Yeah,
I think Vegas. Wasn't it the same weekend? So it was like Mac first, Granite Game was second, and then Vegas and Atlas Games were
I think they were the same weekend. Yeah, they were.
So I wound up doing the Atlas Games. Yeah, I did the Atlas Games, not knowing that it would be so stacked full of guys.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I feel like the men's side of the Atlas Games was crazy.
Well, you had all the Canadians. basically.
And they're good.
Yeah, exactly. Great. You had some, you know, but you held your own in that. I mean, you held your own. You just missed a qualifying spot. At one point, you were in a qualifying spot. Yeah. And I think it was due to some penalties or something like yeah. that kind of, you know, moved you back. But, you know,
yeah.
talk about that. And plus, you're traditionally known as a person that does really well on the online qualifiers.
Sure.
I mean, from your open experience and the games and stuff yep. like that. So you have a lot of experience with that. So mm-hmm. it just seemed like a natural fit for you.
Yeah, I was excited about it. And it was unfortunate. I did take a major penalty on a movement pattern discrepancy.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that put me, the placing that I took from the penalty that I took knocked me from fifth to sixth in the overall.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, hats off. Those guys were, I knew Brent would have a good, I think the last day whenever, looking at the leaderboard, I think he was either, I was in fifth and he was in either sixth or seventh.
Yeah.
I can't remember, but I knew that the rope climb workout mm-hmm. would be like a home run for him.
Yeah.
And I'm like, if I can just, I had done a lot of work this year, my at least as much as I could to try mm-hmm. to get better at those movements, obviously moving forward with Mayhem. Rich does a ton of rope climbs
yep.
and GHDs mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And I knew those were weaknesses of mine. But I knew I obviously wasn't going to beat Brent, but I was just trying to fend him off
yeah.
going into that like yep. clean and jerk burpee workout.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually did the clean and jerk burpee workout and thought I just absolutely crushed it. I was like, man, I just crushed it and we can feel good about moving on. And I saw Brent score and I'm like, what do you do?
Yeah.
You know, like, it's disappointing, but I'm like, I think he took first and first.
Yep. He needed a perfect weekend.
Yeah, he needed a perfect day. Too, or pretty close to
yeah.
it, and he crushed it. So
yeah.
I'm like, hey, what do you do? Like, I gave my best effort, and mm-hmm. he hammered day three, too, and, like, I came up a couple points short, so.
Yeah, do you think, I mean, that's one of the weird things about the online versus the live competition is,
sure.
like, you have that element of, like I said, the standards, or being
sure.
judged a different way, or being judged by someone that's not actually there. I mean, yes, you do have a judge there, but then it's all getting reviewed
yeah.
at the end of the day. But if you're in a live competition, that's not being questioned
right.
at all. So
I think there's like kind of two different things there. Like in a live competition, everyone's racing around you.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do get a no rep, it's a little more like devastating in the moment. And
mm-hmm.
you want to like really react to the judge or,
yeah.
you know what I mean? Versus like in the online stage, for example, with what we did. You're just sitting nervousness,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying? Because you're waiting on the video reviews and them to get back to you.
Yeah.
So to be honest with you, the chest to bar thruster workout, which is what I took the penalty on,
yeah.
no one even had a concern for that one. All of our concerns were like who they were going to hit with like deadlift extension or
yes.
shoulder to overhead lockout
yep.
with those dumbbells.
Yep.
No one was even thinking about the thruster chest to
sure.
bar one. So when I took that penalty, we were kind of like,
that came out of nowhere,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, a little bit. I think mm-hmm. Bailey got hit with a penalty on the deadlift extension one.
Yeah.
And a couple other athletes, like around, I had heard, were getting pinned for that one. So I was not anticipating getting hit with the thruster chest to bar mm-hmm. penalty. But yeah, getting to your point, two totally different judging situations, if you will. But the online qualifiers are definitely stressful, waiting on like that confirmation. Because once
yeah.
you sign that card in live competition, it's not like they're going to go to video review
exactly
or you know
exactly
like, you know where you're at, and you can kind of see where you're at relative
mm-hmm.
to the field too,
yeah,
which is another aspect of the online. But
yeah,
it is what it is.
Yeah. And then you finished sixth in that, tough. But then, you know, we had the last chance qualifier.
Sure.
So you go into the last chance qualifier, and again, you had a stacked field in the last chance qualifier, and it's even worse, not worse, but you have all these people fighting for two spots, and it's not just the U.S. or North America, it's worldwide.
Yep.
And again, you come up short.
Mm-hmm.
However, there was a little bit of a possibility that maybe yep. you could have made it, because one of the athletes wasn't going to make it. So
sure.
Talk about that, like just, you know, coming up short again, the feeling of coming up short again, but then, you know, then holding on to your hope that maybe you could still make the games.
Sure. Definitely like wind out of the sails type,
mm-hmm.
coming in sixth and then coming in third on the last chance part. I do feel like something to take away from my season, like on the overall, is like, God has a plan for our life, and
mm-hmm.
like there's a message in every season, right? Like whether or not you listen to it and want to move forward with it, that's up to you. But I do feel like he has a plan for me, and like it was like revealing to me on some things.
Yeah.
I will say this off season, the work that I've done, like with Mayhem and with Jake, I felt like I was very prepared, as prepared as I could be for both competitions.
Yeah.
So I have no like hang-ups with either of those finishes. Sure. Both of them were like me laying the hammer, you know, as best as I could, and it's just, again, an unfortunate penalty, and then falling where it may in the third spot. On the end of it, of what like was kind of in the air after the last chance, was my mindset, at least, was straight competitor mode. I was like, as soon as all of that happened, I reached out to CrossFit, and I was like, I understand that we were like in a weird circumstance, right? We're like, a guy possibly is not going to make it, not because he's going to decline it or accept it. If he declines it, I'm not sure if that invite gets pushed.
Sure.
But there was like rumor, and kind of in the past, he has been unable to make it into the United States. So my mentality was like, okay, I'm going, you know what I mean? Because I'm not going to, it was, that part was like a wrestle, right? Of saying, okay, maybe I don't have to train as hard today or whatever, because I might not be going. I'm like, nope, if I'm going, I'm going to show up prepared.
Yeah.
So I wound up staying. On the other note, Bailey had an unbelievable 2021 semifinal where she won the Atlas Games. So I kind of got lucky too there, because she was going to stay and train with the whole Mayhem group. And I was going to stay there and train with her and make sure that she was prepared. And I don't know, it all made for like a situation where I got the opportunity to prepare as if I was going to be competing.
And you got to see that too. You got to see that preparation from a new camp. And we'll talk about Mayhem and you training with them, but you got to see how they prepared. So now, coming in this season, you know what to expect, especially since there really hasn't been any change to the season format.
Right.
But again, you mentioned Bailey making it, and you went, you know, obviously you and Bailey, you've been dating for how long now?
5 or 6 years.
5 and 6 years, but you're able to.
She'll be mad at me. You know,
we won't. We'll edit that one out. We're not.
Don't tell her.
We're not. But we'll. You're able to go attend the games as her coach, and follow her through that journey. And you've been there. Both of you have been there together at the games. But then going as an individual, it's a totally different. I imagine a totally different feeling than going as a team, because one is, you know, you're around the top athletes, and it seems like they keep the teams and individuals almost separated. You very rarely do you cross paths.
Yep.
But talk about being back there, being there with her, and watching her succeed. I mean, she was one of those people. I mean, I'll be one to admit, I didn't think that she'd be finished top 20, and I, you know, but I've been wrong on many things. But she had an unbelievable performance.
A little engine that could.
Yes.
That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
From a coaching perspective, with her, I was so impressed by, as her rookie year, with the amount of like firepower that she was around. And she didn't have, I will say, like a super high expectation going into the season two, right? Coming off of a 2020 injury.
Yeah.
And then, you know, just her mindset of, I just want to go have the best 2021 that I could possibly have. She's like, you know, she's like, I want to go to a semifinal and just, and do really well, best that I can.
Yeah.
And then she comes up a couple places short of a semifinal bid. You know what I'm saying? So there's a ton of disappointment there. And all of a sudden there's like some declines, and she makes it into that semifinal and then absolutely knocks it out of the park on day three at her semifinal and qualifies. Then she goes to the games. And so we're getting to like kind of my perspective on coaching her at the games.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say super favorable programming for her at the games.
No, no.
But also I do understand that the games is naturally heavier, right? Because they want to see who can run and also who can squat clean and power clean very heavy weight.
Yeah.
So I got to see like a really cool, not competing and getting to be in the stands watching, I got to see her have some moments that would possibly like break an athlete or were like really defining moments, and her handle them like very, very well for someone who, it's her first time there. You know, like standing on the floor, now I'm getting a little choked up about it, but like that clean ladder run, seeing her like attack that bar, that's like her worst nightmare, not being able to lift a bar like, with a crowd all around her, and to see her like attack it with like the joy, and just, it was cool to see her like approach that.
I think a lot of us felt that. I mean, obviously you have a deeper connection, but it seemed like, I think one thing that I noticed in knowing her and knowing you was how much she was in the moment and enjoying it all.
Oh,
like, it didn't matter if she finished dead last or, you know, fifth or, you know, first. She had the same smile on her face, whether it was the clean and jerk.
Yep.
And or the snatch, I'm sorry, the snatch. Yep. The snatch. She did well in that. And I remember a big smile on her face, and yeah, the handstand walk is one that sticks out. I mean, seeing her cross that finish line and winning her heat and just full of joy. I'm sure, like you said, you're getting choked up, you know, thinking about that. But for you to be a part of that and help her get to that point and then also kind of witness that.
I would say, like, that's the coolest perspective from the coaching side is, like, the whole world sees the handstand walk and the little clip of her excited after it.
Yeah.
What not everybody sees is the maybe, like, the fear of going into that clean run workout and then but I know it
yeah.
you know what I mean so
yeah.
like there everyone sees like that and I'm like man that was just you know everyone loves the handstand walk heat win or I think she won the heat right I'm pretty
yeah,
sure
she won her heat yeah
and then but the clean one and just seeing her like get back on the bar and you know just keep giving it rips mm-hmm. and not getting disappointed and then you nailed it on the snatch one it's like that's the epitome of like yeah you're gonna have some girl snatch 210 220 whatever yeah. it's like if this is my best bar and my best effort right here and you hit it and the next one you don't, that's okay.
Talk about like for a rookie and you kind of felt this too, I think with your games experience, but knowing that you belong there, like she finished 18th, but she knows now where does that confidence help her or anyone else going to the next season knowing that you belong?
Yeah, absolutely.
So the expectations are raised too.
Yeah, you can definitely let the expectation get the best of you. I would say they can, right? But also if you just keep approaching every training day and approach every competition, I mean, we talk about it all the time, right? Like your best effort, my best effort here. Let's have a training day that gets me just a little bit better today, one day at a time. That's what ultimately it takes you from 18th to maybe top 10.
Yeah.
You know, it's not necessarily like we got all this expectation now just because you finished 18th. There's just as much of potential that you don't handle the day-to-day stuff and the effort, and you have a worse finish.
Exactly.
You know, you just never know. So I would say that she should definitely, with her mindset and what she proves she can do in 2021, if she just handles the small details and continues to work hard, I don't see why, with the same mentality and approach, she couldn't have a better year.
Let's talk about you, and let's get back to Mayhem. So what caused you, I mean, I think it's a perfect fit because knowing Mayhem, they have four cornerstones: faith, family, fitness, and service.
Yep.
And I think that falls right along with you and Bailey's values. What else drew you to Mayhem as well?
That was a major factor in it, is just being able to have, you know, the like-mindedness. And I think that led to like the relationships, right? So when we went and visited, we formed relationships with people there. And the guy that I'm working with, Jake Locker, I mean, he and I see eye to eye on several things. I love our relationship. It's honest. I feel like if he needed to tell me something tough or hold me accountable to something, I feel like he could and would.
Yeah.
And, you know, vice versa. I have some roots in Tennessee as well.
Okay.
So my mother's from Tennessee. Some of my mom's family's from Tennessee. My mom and dad met in Tennessee. That's where my dad played football. My mom went to school. Yeah. They met there.
Okay.
So I have roots there. I spent some time there. I lived in West Tennessee for 5 years growing up. So Tennessee is kind of a second home, I guess, if you will, too. So, yeah, values aligned. Moving forward, obviously, Rich is one of the best, you know, to ever do it.
Yep.
Possibly the best ever.
Yep.
As far on the programming side, you have to trust that he knows what he's doing.
Sure.
If you're going to go to a training camp and train with a group of guys, like, he's the guy you want to spend time around. I mean, and he's a hard worker. It's you know, it's in him, so obviously that leaks into everyone around him that spends time there training. So I don't know, it just made sense for the fit.
Are you excited, especially with these new additions? I mean, you have Guy, you have Lazar, you know, they might not be there all the time, but you know, the prospect of being able to train with guys like that who you can push each other.
Yep, definitely. I think that's super beneficial, especially as you get into a part of a season where you do need to ramp up the intensity, and having some guys around you sometimes that can beat you up a little bit is good for you. Not necessarily all the time.
Sure.
Like you said, but we kind of did that last year. I mean,
with Samuel and
Sam and I became really close this year too. He and I, and then Royce came in to prep a little bit before. I don't remember how many weeks out he came in, but yeah, we had a good group of guys training and prepping as obviously, they wound up competing. I was prepping as well, didn't get to compete, but still was a wonderful experience and spent time with those guys. So I really enjoyed it.
And plus, you get to train with Rich. I mean,
yeah, I mean, you can look at that as like, that's a great, really awesome thing. Or like,
so I did a weekend train with Rich. Yeah. It wasn't awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. You're like, man, that's so awesome. You get to train with Rich. I'm like, yeah, until you're on day three and like, you barely want to get out of bed because you're sore.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you're just scared of what he might write up there, but after a little while, you kind of get used to it.
You know what's coming. You just get used
to him just hammering you anyway, so it's like, all right, who's coming in second today? Like, we're just going to try to catch him all day or every week or whatever. You got to get better doing that, right?
Yeah. Like, so what are your off-season plans? Obviously, you're preparing for the 2022, but are you planning on competing in any of these off-season competitions? Obviously, you know, Dubai, you're not going to that boat, like, Wadapalooza, is that a possibility?
Yep.
Individual team?
Table. Individual, yeah.
Okay, cool.
I've competed at Wadapalooza on a team before.
Yep.
I did the elite teams of three, and then I also did the, I think it was the, whenever it was the
2019, yeah, team of four.
We did that 2019 sanctional at Wadapalooza. And I've always enjoyed going to Miami. I mean, that's a cool spot to go
I mean,
work out.
Nixon, Missouri in January or Miami in January? Nothing against Nixon.
Nixon's a wonderful place.
I love this place. But you know,
Miami's a pretty cool spot to be when it's, you know, 38
exactly.
and windy here.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Wadapalooza is on the menu right now.
Cool.
I think I haven't accepted the invite yet, but will be most likely.
Yeah. Cool.
Off-season wise, I've just been spending time kind of dialing back a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously the training has still been consistent.
Sure.
Maybe not as much intensity and not quite as much volume, but spending some time healing up. No major injuries, but obviously like after a summer full, I mean, I competed like 5 times and not competed the games, but still coming off of that training, just like letting my body and mind kind of draw back a little bit, take some time, spend some time with family and friends and spend some time in the gym here. But other than that,
what else you got? Is there anything new, sponsorships or, you know, or anything that you have in the future that you'd like to share? Or
I'm still working with, I mean, I've been part of Noble for a while.
You're an OG Nobler.
I've been around Noble for a little bit.
Yeah.
Man, those guys they're doing something special.
Yeah.
Obviously 2021, their first title sponsor of the games.
Exactly.
First form on my supplement in, and then I just recently started working with RP Strength.
Okay.
So kind of trying to dial in the nutrition side of things. I've had a little bit of a handle on it, but not like, you know, not completely dialed in.
Yeah.
So I think that's something that can maybe move the needle a little bit this year. So, and then planning on spending some time back and forth in Cookeville, more time in Cookeville, take a couple more butt kickings and maybe try to get myself ready for 2022 season.
Well, I doubt there'll be that many butt kickings, but you know. But
well, they're highly likely.
I think you need to give yourself a little bit more credit than that. But yeah, well, hey, appreciate it, and we look forward to watching, and hopefully, we'll see you up in Madison this year.
Cool, man.
All right.